8 a.m. Work begins with everyday cleaning chores. Others deal with the mounds of mail Padre Pio receives every day. Pietro Cugino, born in 1912, remembers. Petruccio, as he is called, was 8 years of age when he first met Padre Pio. It was Padre Pio himself who prepared him for his first communion. He became blind as a result of an illness contracted when he was 12. His blindness does not prevent him carrying out his duty of bearing the letters from the post office to the monastery. Padre Pio receives countless letters from Italy and from all over the world. Devotees from all walks of life turn to him. Ordinary people, scholars, artists, bishops, cardinals, even princes and kings. The extent of the huge correspondence can be gauged from the bi-monthly reports on the number, origin, and content of the letters, which the monastery superiors then have to send to the Holy Office. Back in 1935, 4,127 letters were received. By 1960, over just a two-month period, May and June, 74,000 letters arrived. Requests for secular and spiritual favors, pleas for prayers in general, expressions of thanks for received favors were the main messages of the letters, which eventually became so numerous, a special post office run by the friars had to be established. Under the supervision of their superiors, the friars replied on behalf of Padre Pio, who, weighed down with so many requests, would feel obliged pray even harder. In addition to the correspondence, there is a big demand for confession with Padre Pio, so the friars have to take bookings with all names recorded in a register, a very rare occurrence in the history of the church. Waiting time for confession with Padre Pio averages between 1 and 3 weeks. On the day of confession, a friar gives pink tokens to people who have traveled long distances and yellow ones to the locals. The procedure never varies and is carried out without preference or favoritism, not even for Michele Forgione, Padre Pio's brother. Padre Pio has been described as a martyr of the confessional. For him, confession is a sacred obligation. He can be brusque. Sometimes he even dismisses people without absolution. But this has also been described as his charisma as a confessor. For those whom he has treated brusquely or dismissed without absolution have no peace until they return to kneel at his feet in sincere repentance. He is then like a loving father, a father who only wishes, as he has written, to free his brothers from Satan's snare. At 11 a.m., Padre Pio gives Holy Communion to those who have confessed to him, all of whom are intent on receiving the host from his stigmatized hand. Intense suffering since the early years of his vocation. Satan, his great enemy, masquerades behind the skepticism of those who doubt the visible phenomenon of his stigmata, given to him at the foot of this crucifix by a mysterious presence whose hands, feet, and side dripped with blood. Padre Pio regarded his stigmata not as a blessing, but as God's punishment. A punishment that God in his infinite justice gave him for his sins and the sins of mankind. This is the correct view of the stigmata, because the wounds of Jesus are certainly not a blessing, but God's affliction on an innocent for the sins of the world. At the same time, we must remember that for Padre Pio, the stigmata was a way of physically, externally, and bodily conforming to Christ, who rose from the dead after his crucifixion and whom he loved so much. As Christ suffered and died for souls, his stigmata was a means of cooperating with Jesus for the salvation of souls and the good of the church. These extraordinary images have been closely guarded up to the present day by the vice postulator, Father Gerardo de Blumeri, spiritual son of Padre Pio and witness to his life. These pictures are now made public on the occasion of his canonization and brought to the faithful with the aim of preserving their simplicity and uniqueness. This footage of Padre Pio, cast almost as an actor, had a hugely affecting quality. His obviously reluctant participation in the filming underlines the simplicity of the man who was to be raised to sainthood. These pictures capture the awe and reverence felt by those who passed close to him, were able to touch him, could ask for a prayer, some advice, a blessing. Returning to the serene atmosphere of the monastery of San Giovanni Rotondo, it is the sound of the so-called capo or gong that at midday summons the friars to the room where they share a simple meal. Padre Pio arrives slightly later than his brothers, having first come to the monastery's vegetable garden to bless the sick, the animals, and the vehicles. When Padre Pio entered the refectory, after the blessing in the vegetable garden, the friars would stand as a mark of respect and would remain standing until he sat at his place of table. However, before taking his seat, he would kneel on the floor, open his arms, and pray. Once seated, he would pray once more, as prescribed by the constitution of the rules of the Franciscans. He would then eat his frugal meal. I shared many meals with him, and would sit opposite him to see what he would eat. I mean, he would eat little or nothing, so it has always been a puzzle to me how he could stay alive on so little food in addition to being so active. But evidently the power of God sustains him in his path and his hard work. After lunch, there is a rest period during which the friars play relaxing games and take healthy strolls in the tree-lined paths of the monastery. Choir for vespers, and then resume work until sunset. The friars who are free from work take part in the evening service conducted by Padre Pio. His services always conclude with the faithful pressing forward, which he doesn't always welcome. He's like a good father, full of love for his children, but also ready to chastise them in order to instruct them, and with love to point them in the right direction. The day is drawing to a close. Soon the friars will retreat to their cells for a well-deserved rest. There's time for half an hour of calm recreation, in which Padre Pio often takes part. He regards all his companions as true brothers in Christ, and as children like him of the same spiritual father and same family. He enjoys his time with them, and for their part, they love listening to his simple moral stories. They all want to be his spiritual children, and he fondly accepts them, hearing their confessions, being saddened by their departures, and eagerly awaiting their arrival, bestowing great brotherly love and even greater fatherly love on them all. He would remember the date of birth, the birthday, and the name day of each brother, and at the eve of the festivity he would extend his good wishes to that brother, always with the words, "Tomorrow I will celebrate the Holy Mass for you." It is the same for me on the 15th of October, 1963, or 64, I can't remember well. He gave me his good wishes and then said, "Tomorrow I'll celebrate the Holy Mass according to your wishes." The following day, the 16th of October, was my name day, St. Gerardo Maera. I went to work like every day in the office, which was situated and still is on the first floor of the monastery. Between 11 a.m. and midday, Padre Pio would go to the choir in the gallery once reserved for women to pray for the faithful who were in the church. On his way, he would have to pass by my office. He would always knock on my door and give me some letters, a recommendation or an offering for the hospital. He would often say to me, "Listen, my son, should I die, remember that in my right pocket there are offerings for holy masses. Have them celebrated. And in my left pocket there are offerings for the hospital. Pass them onto the hospital." Such was his extreme consideration in matters of poverty and money. And I would reply, "Certainly, Father, rest assured." Well, on that morning I didn't hear Padre Pio leaving room number one, heading towards the choir and the women's gallery. So I was a little suspicious and apprehensive. While I was thinking, who knows, perhaps he's not feeling well, I heard a little rustle beyond my office door, so I stood up and went to the door. When he saw me, he smiled even more and said to me, "Here, this is for you. Best wishes on your name day." Of course, I was moved, and I hugged him, kissed his hand, and thanked him. I keep that little flower among my most treasured possessions because it reminds me of a gesture of love. A gesture of tenderness on the part of Padre Pio.
when she died, the stigmata disappeared. Yes. The day of his death, completely.
still in the evening. And I would like to read something what the Pope Paul VI said about Padre Pio. What a fame he had, how many followers from around the world. Why? Was it because he was a philosopher, a scholar, or because he had means at his disposal? No, it was because he said Mass humbly, and you have seen the Mass of Padre Pio. Your confession, from morning until night, and was a mark representative of the stigmata of our Lord Jesus Christ, as I told you. He was a true lament of prayer and the suffering. This is the Pope talking. But now, Padre Pio received a lot of gift from God to be a healer. For this reason, many people came to continue to come to San Juan de Letrun to ask Padre Pio to be cured spiritually, the sinners, the sick, to cure with their body. For all the people are coming from everywhere in the world, rich and poor, priests, friars, and laymen, everyone come to San Juan de Letrun. But if you are coming to San Juan de Letrun, not only to ask, but only to learn from Padre Pio, to love God, to love Jesus Christ, to pray, and to accept the suffering children, to offer them to God for our salvation, and to love our brothers, as the Padre Pio did, especially the sick, the poor, and the sinners. Generally, we sometimes pray only for ourselves. We forget to pray for our brothers, especially we must pray as the Padre Pio prayed for the Church, for the Pope, bishops, and the clergy. Padre Pio prayed also for the souls of the purgatory. He prayed especially Our Lady, Saint the Rosary, and he encouraged all the people to say the Rosary. How many Rosaries said Padre Pio during one day, it's impossible to count them. For this reason, the Church recognized Padre Pio as the apostle of the Holy Rosary. Padre Pio encouraged everyone with these words: I would like to have a voice so strong to tell everyone, love and love our Lady and say the Rosary every day. He prayed for the souls of the purgatory. We have nice books here telling us and encouraging us to pray for the souls of purgatory because they need our help. But if you pray the guardian angels and St. Michael Archangel, this was the life of Padre Pio. And we are called by the Church to imitate the steps of Padre Pio. In what? Making miracles? No. To give the perfume? No. Only to love God and to love our brothers. And to put at the center of our life the prayer. To pray according to the intention of the Church, for ourselves and for the priests and people, because we need your help. Now, have you something to ask me before the blessing?